Hey everybody, this is Tracy here with another edition of A View from Tracy's Point. And we are here with an R. Kelly update on what's going on with him in the trial. And then also I'm going to do a non-R. Kelly update because there's been so much going on behind the scenes that really has nothing to do with R. Kelly. And you guys keep reaching out to me saying, you know, why won't you come and talk about this? Come, you know, give us your thoughts on this. And so I just want to let you guys know that when I'm doing these videos on R. Kelly, it's really to, you know, give updates to people who may not be following, you know, the news story, may not have, you know, alerts set up to talk about him. And over the past few weeks, there really hadn't been much going on as far as his case is concerned. And so that's why I haven't been doing any update videos, because I didn't feel that there was really anything to update you guys on. But over the past few days, there has been some information that's come out, and so I am going to go ahead and do the video and talk about that. And then on the back end, I will talk about all the behind the scenes drama that's going on. So let's go ahead and get started. Okay, guys, so just this quick notation before I get into the video. As I was editing the video, Steve Greenberg came out with this tweet, basically saying that R. Kelly has been moved from solitary confinement to general population. That happened today, and I'm pointing that out now because as you go into the video, I'm actually going to talk about the motions that he filed about R. Kelly being in solitary confinement and what the courts came back and what the federal prosecutors came back and said was really going on. And so he has been moved. So when you get to that commentary, you can still listen to what my opinion was, what my point of view was on that. But I did state that he was scheduled to be moved later this week, but that move actually happened today. So Steve Greenberg, about a week ago, he filed a motion responding to the fact that, remember, at the last hearing, R. Kelly wasn't there and the judge was perturbed about it. And so people were saying, you know, why was the judge acting like that? You know, he didn't have to be there. Then the prosecutors were saying that they had made arrangements for him to come to court, and something happened behind the scenes. And then Steve Greenberg didn't want to talk about it on camera. He wanted to go to the judge's chambers to discuss what was going on. And so in his response, he basically said that he didn't believe that R. Kelly needed to be there, but the marshals never came to pick R. Kelly up, was in essence what he was saying, that they never came to get him. So my thoughts on this is, if you've been following the hearings, if you've been following my channels talking about the hearings, you know that that judge has been adamant about R. Kelly being in court. And the judge has said time and time and time again that R. Kelly has to be at every single hearing. And he explained a while ago that the reason it's important for him to be at every hearing is because if something comes up during the hearing, he needs to be there and make sure, you know, R. Kelly needs to be there to hear it. And then as the judge, he needs to make sure that R. Kelly understands what's happening, you know, what's going on. And so a perfect example was R. Kelly wasn't in court at that last hearing, and the prosecutors are trying to raise his bail. And so he needed to be there to hear why they were trying to raise his bail, on what grounds, and, you know, all of that good stuff. So people were saying, you know, the judge was being unfair, you know, he's against R. Kelly. But if you really pay attention, you realize he's not, he's doing his job, is basically what he's doing. And so R. Kelly needed to be there. And we never did get much clarity as to what was going on. Even when Steve Greenberg, you know, presented his motion, and he once again, he keeps saying that R. Kelly has never missed a hearing before. And that is not true, because at the beginning of all of this, R. Kelly did miss a hearing, and the judge admonished him about R. Kelly not being in court that day, and he said that R. Kelly wasn't feeling well. And so it's just little things like that that Steve Greenberg keeps doing that's kind of like annoying to me, because I think that, you know, it may seem minor to him, but it might be something big to the judge when the judge is sitting there reading the motion, where you're trying to, you know, get your where you're addressing what he's saying in court, and you're not being 100% truthful, you know, in your motion. And I'm sure when the judge read that motion, the first thing that jumped out is, why do you keep saying this man has never missed a hearing when he has missed a hearing? And it was like the second hearing, and he said that R. Kelly wasn't feeling well, and he woke up that morning and he wasn't feeling well. And I can't remember, God, it was something had happened or something had come out. Maybe it was when they added the extra charges. I can't remember, but it was something that happened right before that hearing. And then when they had the hearing, R. Kelly didn't show up. And I remember thinking to myself, like, he's probably getting depressed about, you know, what all is going on. But I can't remember exactly what it was that he was upset about. And so the motion that he filed was a response to the motion to increase bond. And I'll read a little bit of this. It says, "Now comes the defendant, Robert Kelly, by the undersigned counsel, and for his response to the request to increase his bond, he states the following. One, defendant is charged in these cases with aggravated criminal sexual abuse, aggravated criminal sexual assault, and criminal sexual assault, before being arrested in July on other charges, allegations which entirely preceded these indictments. Mr. Kelly was free on a $250,000 bond in each of these cases, or a total of $1 million." And because, you know, he only has to pay like a certain percent. And so it says, "On August 15th, 2019, the prosecution told the court that Mr. Kelly had refused to come to court, and that representation was not accurate. Following that, they told the court they had filed a motion to increase bond. What had factually occurred is that prior to the court date, there was a number of distinct and separate discussions between the prosecution, the defense, the United States Marshal Service, and the Cook County Sheriff's Office regarding transportation and security issues concerning Mr. Kelly. These included considerations of the complications with transporting such a high-profile prisoner, as well as the massive measures needed to be undertaken at the Cook County Courthouse to accommodate both security and media concerns. Four, the defense was informed that in order to transport Mr. Kelly, unlike with the traditional federal prisoner, a small motorcade would be required, disrupting traffic and tying up officers who could otherwise be deployed. Number five, the defense was further informed that after he arrived at the courthouse, the process of moving Mr. Kelly to the lockup, then to court, and back to the lockup could require all other inmate movement to halt, delaying the proceedings in all of the other courtrooms on the same side of the courthouse, not to mention the additional security that is otherwise required and time the case is on the call and Mr. Kelly in the building. So five, given these concerns, there are certainly a mutual understanding that Mr. Kelly was not going to be brought to the August 15, 2019 court date, which was to be nothing more than a routine discovery status check." Now, I'm gonna stop right there because there's some more points to this. So if they had came to this conclusion that it was going to be too difficult for him to come to court, why didn't anybody feel the need to inform the judge that he wouldn't be there and get the judge's response and his approval for R. Kelly not to come to court? Because once again, the man has been very adamant in every hearing that he must be present. So why would they even risk upsetting the judge by not involving him in this conversation? And then when they were talking about moving R. Kelly from wherever he's being held at the MCC and bringing him to court. Now, I've never been to Chicago, never been to the federal courthouse in Chicago or the criminal court building or anywhere in Chicago, because I ain't never been to Chicago. But what I was thinking about as I was reading this, because you guys know I've told you the whole story about my ex. And, you know, he's in federal prison right now. And so I can remember when he was being transported to, you know, from the wherever he was locked up at to the federal courthouse in downtown Tampa. He would be in a van, like a, you know, the marshal's vans. They would have them, you know, chained to the seats, chained, the ankles chained to the, you know, the bars underneath the seat. They would have U.S. Marshals on the van. Now, granted, he's no R. Kelly, but, you know, for Steve Greenberg to be going on and on about, you know, what all would be needed to transport him because he's a high-profile client, keep in mind that R. Kelly, when he was out on bond going to the county courthouse, like, he was parked down the street in the parking lot on the side of the road. He got out with his security team, walked to the courthouse, you know, to go inside. So I'm not sure what he think is going to happen now that he's, like, does he think there's going to be a prison break? Like, what is he, what is Steve Greenberg thinking about? And so anyway, back to my ex. Now, so when he would be transported, they would take him. So behind the federal courthouse and even the regular courthouse, they brought the prisoners in through the back, and it was sort of like a docking area, and they would bring them in back there. They would go in through the back of the courthouse. They had holding cells in the back of the courthouse that was not visible to the public. And I think it's the same way here, because actually our county jail here is next door to the courthouse complex, the county level courthouse complex. And so they bring those prisoners in through the back. You know, they're not visible to the public. They're not accessible to the public. They bring them in through the back. They have holding cells back there. At the county level, they actually have everybody in the courtroom together. And then you go up and you talk to the judge one by one so everybody can hear all your business and what's going on. And a lot of the hearings that they have are the same way, except for, like, you know, in a criminal case when the trial is actually going on, then of course it's just you and, you know, your family, friends, whoever's supporting you. But anyway, I'm meandering off topic. So basically they bring these people in through the back. There's no, you know, they're not walking down the hallway past the public, you know, that's there. They come in through a door. They come into the courtroom through a door in the back of the courtroom, or the front of the courtroom, because it's by the judge's area. And so I just really don't know what Steve Greenberg is talking about, where he's saying that, you know, R. Kelly would disrupt the whole courthouse, you know, coming through. I mean, he is just, I'm losing confidence in him as the days go on, because there are procedures in place. And then I was telling somebody about, even when they were in the federal courthouse, so like R. Kelly, when he comes in, because it's at the county level. And then I was also telling somebody that, you know, when R. Kelly has been going to court, you know, he's been in the prison uniforms that they wear. But I can remember they would bring my ex to the courthouse. He would go into this holding cell, and then he would change out of the prison garb into street clothes. And then they would bring him out, you know, like from that back door, they would bring him into the courthouse. So maybe they do things different in Chicago. I don't know. But I would just think that it's kind of uniform across the country, that this is how prisoners are held. I don't know. But he seems to think that there is a big threat to R. Kelly coming to court. So then number seven, it says, at no time on August 15, 2019, did anyone approach Mr. Kelly at the Metropolitan Correctional Center and attempt to bring him to the courthouse on 26 in California, nor for that matter did anyone other than his counsel ever discuss these potential issues with him. Defense would like to be clear, Mr. Kelly never refused to be transported. Number eight, regarding Mr. Kelly and his appearing in court, both now and historically, and then he adds bullet points, he says Mr. Kelly voluntarily turned himself in on the aforementioned charges. When the charges in one of the cases were upgraded, Mr. Kelly again voluntarily appeared. When the charges in one of the cases was upgraded, there was no motion to increase Mr. Kelly's bail. Mr. Kelly has appeared at each and every court date except his last court date, which I've already told you, he missed another court date when he wasn't feeling well. But that was due to no fault of Mr. Kelly's. Rather, his absence was due to not being brought over by the proper authorities and the agreement the prosecution refuses to acknowledge. And it says he was entirely cooperative with the federal authorities when they approached to arrest him. He appeared in each and every court date in this prior prosecution as well, which spanned almost a decade. And it says Mr. Kelly has been 100% compliant with pretrial. Thus, to summarize, Mr. Kelly has always voluntarily turned himself in when asked and never violated a condition of his bail. And then he just goes on and on and on, basically saying the same thing, just worded differently, I guess, to give more bullet points to what's going on. Oh, and then I thought it was interesting that somebody made a comment on Twitter where they were saying that it's so strange that no video footage has surfaced of R. Kelly being arrested, and was basically saying, you know, if you think back to the Jussie Smollett case, all those cameras, all these, you know, video footage and vantage points that they had of Jussie going from point A to point B to point C and back to point A again. But with R. Kelly's arrest, there has been no video footage. And then I was thinking to myself, you know, that is so true, because TMZ seems to be able to find video footage whenever NFL or NBA player or even Bow Wow, you know, got into the fight on the elevator at the hotels. They can seem to get that footage, but they haven't been able to get any footage of R. Kelly walking down the street, walking his dog, and getting picked up by the feds. And I just find that is very, very interesting. We go down to number 14. It says, Illinois' law does not permit the increase of bail simply because someone has been charged with another crime in this or any other jurisdiction, unless that other crime and its commission is a violation of the conditions of the existing bail. Number 15, the prosecution does not allege that Mr. Kelly has violated any condition of his bail, nor do they allege that as a result of these other charges, he is an increased flight risk. They sadly do not allege anything at all. So that was a good point there. Number 16, given the lack of both legal and factual substance to the request, it should be denied without hearing. Like, we don't even need to come back in here and discuss this matter. You need to review the facts and let this go. So that was it on his motion regarding the increased bail, and then further reiterating why R. Kelly did not show up for court. So then another story came out, and then this story broke on over the weekend. So because Steve Greenberg filed these motions, you know, basically saying that the other motion that Steve Greenberg filed was regarding R. Kelly being in solitary confinement, you know, which he refers to as the hole. And so he was stating that, you know, he's being treated unfairly, that he's in lockup, and the type of lockup that he's in is for people that have had disciplinary issues in general population, and you know that's why they call it the hole, because they put them in this little small cell that has no windows, no lighting, and they're locked up like 23 hours a day. They serve them their food like through the door, that type of thing. So he was claiming that this is where R. Kelly is, and that, you know, is inhumane treatment, that they are doing him like this, and that he wants to be removed from this area of the prison. And so if you guys remember, and I was trying to go back and find the article where I read this at, but it was Nicole Becker, and she had stated that R. Kelly was no longer in this high level of lockup that they were claiming, like the hole or whatever. And she was saying that he was in another, it was still like separated from general population, but he was in a bigger cell, and he had, you know, he could use the phone and that type of thing. And I thought I talked about this in another video about a month or so ago, but I couldn't find the notes. But anyway, now that he's Steve Greenberg has filed this motion, they're now coming out saying that it's not true. So here's an article from WGN9. It says, federal prosecutors say R. Kelly has had a cellmate for some time, refuting a claim by the singer's attorneys in which they are seeking Kelly's release from what they describe as cruel and unusual punishment in solitary confinement. And it says, in a Friday court filing, prosecutors say Kelly has had a cellmate for some time at the Metropolitan Correctional Center in Chicago, where he's being held. And they also say that Kelly, quote, has had more than one cellmate so far, and even refused an order last month to take a cellmate. And so the Chicago Sun-Times reports that prosecutors contend that the 52-year-old Kelly is seeking special treatment because he's a celebrity. And it says that a judge is scheduled to consider Kelly's attorney's motion next week. And you guys know on Wednesday, September 4th, is his next federal hearing for the charges against him in Chicago. So I'm assuming they're going to talk about this then. And so even though I couldn't find the article, well, actually, I really didn't look that hard. I tried to do a search on Google to find the article. I didn't go back through my videos to see what exactly I was quoting when I talked about this. But anyway, this story that came out yesterday pretty much backs up the fact that he has not been in the hole, as his defense is claiming, which is another reason I'm like starting to have problems with Steve Greenberg. And so then here is an article from the Chicago Tribune, and it says R. Kelly was written up, like we writing people up like we in school being bad and getting detention. It says R. Kelly was written up for refusing to take a cellmate at federal jail in Chicago. Quote, I was told I didn't have to take a celly. So they're kind of like quoting him, as that was his response to being written up. And so it says, after R. Kelly was jailed in the Metropolitan Correctional Center in Chicago last month on child pornography and obstruction of justice charges, the musician was written up for refusing to take a cellmate, according to newly disclosed prison records. It says an incident report said Kelly had rebuffed an order to take a cellmate in the Loop facility special housing unit, a more secure area from the general population. It said, asked to respond to the allegation, Kelly said, quote, I was told I didn't have to take a cellie, and I have too much going on to worry about an incident report. End of quote. And it says investigators wrote that he had a, quote, poor attitude throughout the investigation. Well, I guess if I'm a grown man, 52 years old, somebody write me up like I'm a damn child, I probably would have an attitude also. I probably would be like, I got all these charges against me. I ain't got time for this. Like, is that what they doing in jails? They writing people up and getting people in trouble, treating grown people like they little kids. Like, I don't blame you, R. Kelly. And if somebody told me I ain't have to have a cellmate, then dang on it, I ain't gonna take one. But then it goes on and says the report was filed as part of the government's response to Kelly's motion that he be granted bail so he can be released from custody. Kelly is currently being held without bail on 13 count federal indictment in Chicago. You know, and then it goes on to recap, you know, his charges. And it says Kelly's motion filed August 1st argued that he has been subjected to, quote, draconian conditions, end quote, while jailed in the special housing unit. The musician's lawyer has filed a separate motion on Thursday that asks for Kelly's, quote, immediate release from solitary confinement, end quote. And then it says, in a response, federal prosecutors maintain that Kelly should remain jailed because he is a flight risk and a danger to the public. They wrote that they plan to file a separate response to Kelly's request to be released from solitary confinement, but noted that he previously refused an order to take a cellmate. Prosecutors have said Kelly has been assigned a cellmate despite his refusal. So what do you guys think about this whole, he refused a cellmate, he's not in the hole, you know, as, you know, the public considers the hole? Because I know, like I said a few minutes ago, when people say to me somebody's in a hole, I'm thinking about that six, I think it's 6x6, it's a 6x6 cell. If it has a window, it's like a very small window at the top of the wall. There's a steel door that has like a little slot, and then the, you know, the jailers bring them their food, and they can only come out like that 1 hour a day. And I think they go down into the recreation area and they're there by themselves. And so maybe I'm watching too many movies. That's because that's really my only vantage point of the hole. But is that what you all are envisioning when they say the hole? Or do you think he is in a cell that has bars or that has a door with the window, however jails are set up these days? With other people, and that he is communicating with other people? Because I know there were reports that came out that said that he talks on the phone with, you know, Azriel and Jocelyn, and I guess, you know, some other people that he has on his list of people that he calls or can talk to. And I think I read somewhere that Azriel and Jocelyn had actually been added to his visitation list, and that they did go visit him. So what are your views on what's going on with his confinement? There was another article, or it may have been in the motion that he filed about getting him out of solitary confinement. But basically they were saying that when they go to meet with him, that he is in this room, right? It's like not a regular visiting room. It's a small room that doesn't have a table. It just has chairs. And so they sit in these chairs. They have nothing to put their laptops on. They can't put paperwork down. So they need to read to him, you know, things that are going on, court documents, you know, things that he needs to know. And that it's really difficult to interact with him because, you know, they don't have the comfort of, well, I shouldn't say the comfort, but the necessity, you know, the basic necessities to conduct a meeting with their client, because there's no table there. And I never heard of nothing like that, where they just put you in this little small room with two chairs, unless they're just purposely being vindictive and nasty, you know, because they want to be vindictive and nasty. And then in regards to the people that are claiming to be in R. Kelly's inner circle and claiming that they're actually talking to him, I'm wondering, like, are they actually on the visitation list to go visit him at the MCC? Are they on his list for him to be able to make phone calls to these individuals? I'm not sure if they even have a list for that. I know in some places you have to, only certain numbers or something can go out. But, you know, is R. Kelly calling any of these people? I know with my kid's dad, he has a email. He can email people and he can pick and choose who can be on his email list. I don't know if R. Kelly has that capability or not. But if it was me and I was on R. Kelly's visitation list, or I was on one of the people that R. Kelly is calling and talking to, if it was me, I would be like, do you have a message for all the supporters out there, you know, who are showing love for you, who are supporting you, you know, who are praying for you? Do you have a message for them? And I'm sure R. Kelly would give them a message, you know, that they could bring back to the people. And if I was receiving a phone call from R. Kelly, I would ask him, hey, let me record this. Give a message to the people, to the supporters, to let them know that you're okay. And then I would record that conversation and then play it back when I'm on social media going off on people for saying this or saying that or promoting, you know, what's going on with him. And I just find it odd that nobody has done that so far. If you follow the R. Kelly page on Twitter, please go unfollow that page because something has happened. It looks like whoever controlled R. Kelly's page on Twitter, the at R. Kelly, it appears that they have sold that page to somebody. And so now the new page is called Case Number 302. So if you go to at Case Number 302 on Twitter, the page is locked, you know, so you can, you know, send a request to follow so that you can see what's going on the page. Before it went private, they were actually posting like some really sarcastic and negative stuff about R. Kelly on the page. So if you were following that R. Kelly page, go to at Case Number 302 and unfollow that page. Because, you know, people sell social media pages, like they get a lot of views and then they can sell those pages to companies and different people to, you know, so that they don't have to build their following. So say I had a Facebook page that had 1 million people following it. I could then turn around and sell that page to another company that needs a lot of followers, and then they come in, they change the name, they start posting their content, and then all of a sudden you're sitting there like, when did I follow this page? I've never heard of this page before. And that's because that's what's happened behind the scene. Whoever you were following on that page sold that page, and people can get like $1 per like on a page. So a page with 1 million followers, you know, could easily bring in $1 million or $500,000. So selling social media pages is like on the black market, but those transactions do take place. So if you were following that channel on Twitter, please go and unfollow it. I think at this point you can't bring up at R. Kelly. You have to bring up at Case Number 302 to access that page. And so the page at Case Number 302, I just learned as I was doing the video, has been changed, and this is what it's been changed to. And then when I researched that page, you know, to make sure it was the correct information to give you guys so you can go and unfollow it, that page has now been taken down. So case number 302, if you go to that now, it says the page doesn't exist. And then if you go to the second page, it says that that page no longer exists. And so what I think is happening is that as people, R. Kelly supporters, are reporting the page, then whoever's behind that page is changing the name so that the R. Kelly supporters can't find the page. And so if I find out what the new page is, then I'll come back and let you guys know what the new page is. I'll drop it in the comments, but it just lets you know that whoever bought that page paid a bunch of money for it, and they're upset that they're losing those followers on that page. And then the last article that came out this weekend says, it was by the Chicago Sun-Times, and it says, R. Kelly's girlfriend's moving out of Trump Tower condo and singer hopes to join them. Now, I was kind of not really feeling this article. Not sure if this is a story that's being planted by Steve Greenberg in his attempt to get R. Kelly released on bond or not. The story just seemed a little suspect. One, because we've been told all along that R. Kelly's whatever, his lease or whatever on his Trump condo was paid through the end of the year, you know, through December. But now, according to this article, it says the lease is ending and Jocelyn Savage and Azriel Clary are looking for new digs. R. Kelly's lawyer says he will ask a judge to lower his bond next week so he can get out of jail. I don't know how he's going to ask to lower the bond because he ain't got no bond. They didn't issue him a bond in the federal cases. And even if the Chicago federal court does issue him a bond, the New York people didn't issue him a bond. So I'm thinking if he were to get a bond in Chicago, New York is just going to come and swoop him up. So he would still be locked up. So I'm just not understanding the reasoning here. But anyway, the article goes on to say it's moving time for R. Kelly. And apparently his two girlfriends, Jocelyn Savage, 23, and Azriel Clary, 21, who had been living with the R&B singer at his leased condo in Trump Tower until his arrest in July, are now looking for new digs. They are looking to be moved, Kelly's attorney, Steve Greenberg, said. They are not being evicted. I believe their condo lease is paid up for August and perhaps September. The landlord has been great. Now, the other problem I have with that is that there was an article that I read by a realtor who handles sales in Trump Tower. And he said that they have no rental units in Trump Tower, and that to his understanding, people who own condos in Trump Tower were not allowed to lease their units. So I don't know. That was what the realtor said, okay, because he was actually talking about the pricing and that it would be easy for R. Kelly to actually own his unit there. And then also, I thought there were two units in the Trump Tower. So that story seems to keep going back and forth as to whether there's one unit or two units there. But anyway, finish reading this article. Okay, so Sneed, the writer of this article, is also told Greenberg, who tentatively plans to ask a judge to reconsider Kelly's bond and ask for Kelly's release at a status hearing next week, tells him that, quote, my client would live wherever his two girlfriends plan to relocate, and they are looking for a place in Chicago. They all plan to live together. Okay, so considering the charges against R. Kelly, why in the world would you say that he plans to live with Azriel and Jocelyn if he is released, considering Azriel is allegedly one of the people in the New York indictment against him? It would make more sense to me if he would say Azriel and Jocelyn are moving, and then Mr. Kelly would move back into his condo at Trump Tower. He would be there alone, where they can do all this monitoring, you know, put the ankle bracelet on him, set up the monitoring where they can stop by whatever and make sure he's there. They can put the devices in the house, you know, to make sure that he's not leaving, he's not bringing people into the house, that type of thing. I don't understand Steve Greenberg's line of thinking here. So Sneed also is told Kelly is expected to be moved into the Metropolitan Correctional Center's general population next week. It says that Kelly has been held in the special housing unit, a section for at-risk prisoners at the MCC, which is under the auspice of the Federal Bureau of Prisons. It says last Monday, Greenberg filed a request for Kelly's release from SHU because he has been subjected to, quote, cruel and unusual punishment, in part because of his celebrity status. The feds responded, and then I read all this, you know, about the response. Then it has a quote from Steve Greenberg, and it says, my client is not a flight risk or a danger to the community, and the allegations are old. The only reason he is in custody is because he is a high-profile case. And then it says, Kelly faces a combined, and then it goes on, you know, to read the charges. Now, here's another contradiction with Steve Greenberg's strategy. So you're saying he didn't come to court because of all this added security that would be needed to transport him from the MCC to the county courthouse. So to me, if all this added security is needed, then that means that there's a threat out there somewhere that you're anticipating. And that's why all this police escorts and all this stuff needs to take place. Although he was bringing himself to court before the federal indictments happened. But now you're saying you want him released from custody to live on his own, which would indicate that there really is no threat to his life or to his safety if he's released from prison and then can come to court on his own when he has hearings. Do you guys understand what I'm saying? Make it make sense for me. Like, either he's in danger or he's not in danger. You can't have it both ways. And I just think that when the judges are reading these motions, that they're seeing this conflict of interest as well. I don't know. You guys let me know what you think about the whole R. Kelly confinement, the release of bond. I think we all agree that he should be released on bond. We all agree that he's not a threat. We all agree that the notion that he would intimidate witnesses, that he would try to pay people off, makes absolutely no sense. One, because of the severity of the charges against him, and two, because he allegedly has no money to pay anybody off. So, I mean, like, come on, y'all, be for real. So that's the updates on R. Kelly. Now let's move over to the non-R. Kelly news. So you guys have been reaching out to me about all the back and forth, all the drama that's going on between the YouTubers, mainly Dana J, Sharron Wimbush, and Dr. Rice. So Sharron put out some videos and I believe Sharron is Sharron, but whoever is Sharron got a hell of a clapback game, okay? Like, she can play the dozens, and I say she can go from intellectual to hood real quick, okay, when it comes to the clapback. So that seems to have set Dana J off, and so he tried to respond, and so his first response to me read like a script, okay? Like, he had spent some time reflecting over what Sharron had said about him in her clapback. And so he wrote out this long script to respond. And so my thing is, if you can't come back like this on the clapback, don't clapback. Just take the L and call it a day. I guess all of this flurry started with Sharron and, you know, Dana talking about her bringing up the whole Sharron is dead again, which is what ignited everything to start with. Because in his response to Sharron, he was saying stuff like, he was talking about, and I don't know if it was the first video or the second video, but he said that he was talking about the, that was the other thing that came out, was that these stories were planted in the blogs. I didn't see any mainstream media like CBS, NBC, ABC, or reputable news papers reporting this. It was mainly TMZ, The Blast, you know, all these people who are just feeding off of each other, reported that the prosecutors had released information stating that they had R. Kelly's medical records and that he in fact does have a STD. So in Dana J's response, he said that herpes was not an STD. So I just want y'all to know that STD stands for sexually transmitted disease, and that herpes is considered an STD because it is a sexually transmitted disease. And then what else did David J say? Something. Oh, then he said that sharing one of his viewpoints on Sharon being dead is that he had some video footage or something of Sharon working in a garden that she was planting or picking something out of a garden. Don't quote me. It was something she was gardening, and that millionaires, you know, Sharon says she's a millionaire and that millionaires don't garden. And so Oprah has been seen many a times. If you watch Oprah's Soul Sundays on her channel, on the OWN channel, and even in her magazine, Oprah has a garden on her estate. And Oprah be out there planting and digging and picking and, you know, carrying on in her garden. So Oprah's a billionaire. So if Oprah can get out there with her little hand scoop and be out there working in her garden, then I'm sure that Sharon, if she has a garden, that she perfectly well could be out there working in her garden, because gardening has nothing to do with money. Gardening is it's an activity that people enjoy doing. And so that's like, I don't have a lawn man. I enjoy working in my yard. I enjoy mowing my lawn, edging my lawn, planting flowers, all of that. So I do that myself. And my daughter always asks me, Mama, why won't you hire a lawn man? And I tell her, because I enjoy going out there doing it, and I'm going to do it until I can't do it, and then I'll hire a lawn man. So I thought that was funny. But then the last thing that Dana J said that I thought was funny was in one of his videos, he claimed that the judge on the state level case that's hearing R. Kelly state charges, Flood, I think his name is Lawrence Flood, he said that he's actually a federal judge, and that every 6 weeks he has to rotate down to the state level. And I was like, I don't think it worked that way, because first of all, most state judges in most states, those people are elected by the public, like they're on the ballot. And then in some cases they are appointed, but in most states they are elected. And then on the federal level, state federal judges, not state federal judges. So, you know, you have each state has federal judges, and then you have the Supreme Court that has federal judges. And so judges on the Supreme Court are nominated by the president, and then they're confirmed. And then on the state level, those federal judges are appointed usually by a committee, an appointment committee, or by the governor of that state. And so it is a huge privilege to be appointed as a federal judge. So I highly doubt that a federal judge is being transferred down to the state level to hear cases. Now, federal judges do rotate to different types of federal level courts because it prepares them. For, you know, election into the Supreme Court, because they get all this experience on how to handle different cases at the federal level. But I cannot find anything to substantiate that a federal judge would be rotated down to the state level to hear state cases like the one with R. Kelly, state or county cases. And then what I did find out about the Lawrence Flood guy is that his he is an associate, I think it's called an associate justice, and basically that's a level up from, you know, judges that you would see in the courtrooms when you go to a lower level hearing. And basically what the associate judges do at the state level, not at the federal level, is that they do a rotation where if a judge is unseated from a case, or, you know, or loses office, is removed from office, if a judge excuses themselves or recuses themselves from a case, you know, because they have information or there's been some impropriety or the defense has requested that that judge be removed, then the associate judges, they have a rotation where they go in and fill in for those judges that have been removed from a case. But I have never heard of a federal judge being relegated down to hear state cases, because part of being a federal judge is that you've done your time at the lower level. And when I say state level, I'm talking about county courtrooms. Like if you got arrested and had to go down to the county courthouse, the judges that are sitting in there, you paid your dues at that level, and that's part of, and you were so good at it that you were appointed to become a federal judge at the state level. So I think it just would be a slap in the face for a judge to have to go back down and sit at a circuit court level and hear a case, as is what's being happening, you know, like with R. Kelly. I don't see a federal judge go going and sitting on the case that was brought by Kim Fox. I found nothing in my research to support that notion to be true. So that was the other thing that Dana J said that just didn't make sense. And the reason I'm pointing these things out is because if you would get up and just make these assertions about STDs, about, you know, the federal judge and all this other stuff, like what else are you just making up as you go along? But anyway, let me get to my notes about this because I'll go off in left field somewhere. So, let me start with these little stories first. Kenyatta Barnes, I don't know if y'all saw this, but Kenyatta Barnes, you know, she is, I guess, the mute, our head of Mute R. Kelly. You know, she started that whole thing. So, she was in Atlanta at an Applebee's. And, you know, if you ever eat at Applebee's around 9 o'clock or so, they have a DJ come in and DJ play music. They play trivia games, you know, while people eat, give away prizes and stuff. But, yeah, they broke out with some R. Kelly up in there. And then the waitresses or somebody was in there dancing to the R. Kelly. She got in her feelings, called for the manager, told the manager she wasn't paying for her food and that they shouldn't be playing R. Kelly, that she's offended. And child, them people called the police on her or threatened to call the police on her because they was like, "Are you going to eat your food?" And then get mad because R. Kelly is playing. Like, if you don't want to listen to R. Kelly, get up and leave. Get you a doggy bag and go, but you're going to pay for that food. So now she has been called the Applebee's lady. That's Kenyatta Barnes' new title. So if you're on social media and you responding to Kenyatta Barnes and you're talking about Kenyatta Barnes, don't call her Kenyatta Barnes. Call her the Applebee's lady. Then next, Tuesday, which is my birthday. So Tuesday, there was another story that's coming out about this guy named Kevin Terrell. I'm sorry. There's this guy named Kevin Terrell, and he's also a DJ in Chicago, and so he's rented out this restaurant. The restaurant is called Jerk Flavors Restaurant and Lounge, and it's in Matson Town Center, 3039 West 159th Street, Suite B, in Mauchline, Illinois, which I'm thinking is probably like a little suburb of Chicago. And so basically, he's hosting a listening party for R. Kelly, where they're just going to play all R. Kelly music. So if you're in Chicago and you want to check that out, go ahead. But Miss Kenyatta Barnes heard about this, and so she tried to rally her troops to shut this down, and, you know, telling people to call the Matson Town Center, call the owner of the restaurant, and tell them to cancel this event, that, you know, we need to mute R. Kelly and they shouldn't be allowed to have this event. And so here is Kevin's response to the Applebee's lady and her attempt to try and shut down this party that he's hosting.
Let me address something real quick. Okay. So people know that some do, some don't. They know I'm doing a R. Kelly fan supporter listening party. And I posted a flyer, and for some reason, it got to the new R. Kelly page. Okay? All right? So they on there. Talking about we want to shut it down. I think the owner of the YouTube, I mean, the owner of the Mute R. Kelly page, her name is Kenyatta Barnes. The R. Kelly, the Mute R. Kelly, became a bunch of bullies now. You can't tell me what to listen to. You can't tell me what not to promote. You can't tell me what not to play. You can't tell me where not to go. have a right. And just because you don't listen to his music and not a fan of his, doesn't make you no better than me, okay? Now, what I personally think Kenyatta is doing with this mute R. Kelly, I think she's using it for a personal financial gain, like the rest of them, you know. 94. They're just bandwagons, you know, they jumping, everybody is jumping on the bandwagon. And by the way, share this video, because I hope Kenyatta Burns or Mute R. Kelly fans, whoever, you know, everybody trying to make some revenue off R. Kelly's name, okay? Let's keep it real. That lady don't really care if some girls get raped and all that. Let me say this here. If you care so much about people, why ain't find some of these missing women in Chicago? Yeah. If you care so much about black women and black girls matter, why they don't have a special team to look for these black girls that's been missing in Chicago? Can I name one? Remember the postal girl who was supposed to been going to work? They still never found her yet. They still haven't found her. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Y'all ain't coming together for that. This happened in September the 3rd. Listen, I don't care if me too, you too, your mama, your daddy, your cousin, your kids, I don't care. We moving forward. September the 3rd. Yeah. And the crazy part about it is, we didn't really expect a large turnout, but thanks to Mute R. Kelly, they want to take my flyer and put it in their page and all that. I just didn't want to say thank you. You know, they say the haters make you greater, okay? You're already locked up. So what y'all want to do? Y'all getting mad because I'm listening to his music? Y'all getting mad because I'm promoting him? Y'all get mad because I'm supporting him. I'm going to eat this shark's chicken. So, listen, I don't give a fuck about no Mute R. Kelly. I don't give a fuck about no You Too, Me Too, Who Too, Boo Boo, or Foo Foo. I don't care. I'm a grown ass man.
And so if you're in the Chicago area, go out and support this event. If you're truly an R. Kelly supporter and you live in Chicago, please go and show up and support this event to show the Applebee's lady that ain't nobody scared of her, okay? And then growing up hip hop, you guys know that Drea and Buku, and I think maybe one of the other kids was on there. So the growing up hip hop season finale was a week ago, not this past Thursday, but the week before. And I think overall, whatever they were attempting to do, it did not work out. And I got to thinking, you know, Drea probably encouraged all this foolishness because, you know, Drea's alimony, whatever R. Kelly was paying her in alimony, ended in January of this year. And I talked about that in another video. It ended in January of this year. And that's why she's fighting so hard for that child support. And now that, you know, the whole Surviving R. Kelly docuseries has prompted this backlash and he's now locked up, this is probably why she tried to go on Growing Up Hip Hop to promote Buku, so that she can live off of her career. But it seems to have backfired because ain't nobody really checking for Buku. And so I ended up watching the last episode because Twitter was dragging Buku so bad. I felt so sorry for her. And so I was like, oh my God, like the whole season, nobody's really been talking about Drea, talking about Buku being on the show. But they dragged this poor girl so bad. So I went ahead and watched the episode. And so basically it was the season finale. And Buku had a performance. And so she came out. And I had seen this picture before of Buku. I didn't know it was part of growing up hip hop. But she has this really long wig. And half the wig is black. And the other half of the wig is white. But then she doesn't really comb the wig. Like the wig isn't groomed or anything. It's like she just snatched it, you know, off the chair and threw it on her head. And so they were dragging her about that. And then the song that she performed, I barely could understand the words to the song, but they said it was a very sexual song and that she was really trying to copy off of her dad and, you know, steal his flavor. And it just wasn't working because she looks like a little girl. You know, she doesn't look like she's 20 something, 21 years old. She looked like she's about, you know, 14 or 15 years old. So she just looked so awkward and so out of place singing this song. And I mean, she was saying like, I want to F you and all this stuff. And I'm like, oh my God. And Miss Dale was sitting there like, what did that little girl just say? You know, and Drea was like, oh my God. You know, like she was embarrassed, but knew she hadn't heard the song before. So it was a hot mess. But the part I want to talk about is that towards the end of the show, you guys know Eazy-E's daughter was on there. And I think she goes by the name Remarkable. So her and Buku were sitting down talking. And so they got on the conversation about dads. And then you could, you know, Buku was basically saying, you know, that she missed the fact that she doesn't have her dad in her life. And so, you know, Eazy-E is dead. So Remarkable looking at her like, girl, you know, you still got an opportunity, but you could sort of feel the pain in Buku's voice when she was talking about the fact that she doesn't have a relationship with R. Kelly. And so I thought that was very telling, and, you know, it spoke volumes. Like, Drea, if your kids want to talk to their dad, let them kids talk to their dad, because they're going to end up hating you in the end. And so the next day, Sharon Wimbush did a video. Is it Sharon? I keep saying Sharon because I have a friend from high school whose name was Sharon, and she spelled her name with two R's, but I think Sharon pronounces her name Sharon, even though it has the two R's. So Sharon did a video, and it was like a really heartfelt video, and it was such a juxtaposition from what had been going on the previous week, where she cussed Dana J out and then they were going back and forth and then she was on Dr. Rice. But very heartfelt. It was called the R. Kelly Challenge, and it was like an open letter to Buku and Robert Jr. and to the other, Jaya, I think her name is. It was an open letter to them to like put everything aside. You know, your dad, you only get one dad. This is your dad. Make amends. You know, build a relationship for him. Be a support for him while he's going through this. Don't turn your back on him. He's still your family. And so go over to Sharon's channel. You know, it's just her name, Sharon Wimbush. And listen to that video. And I just thought it was such a beautiful video that she did. And not only for R. Kelly's kids, but anybody that's dealing with a strained relationship with a family member or a close friend. I think it was inspiring and encouraging. And, you know, if you have a severed relationship with somebody, listen to that video and, you know, what she's suggesting that you do. Like, you know, write a letter to that person. Write down your feelings every day about, you know, how you feel about the situation. And so go check that out. Now, back to Dana J. So, y'all reaching out to me about Dana J. I said what I had to say about Dana J a few months ago. My feelings have not changed about him. I have always said I believe he knows R. Kelly, that he met R. Kelly. Like I said, one time he said he met him in 1994. Another time he said he met him in 2004. When he says that he's had this 20-year relationship with R. Kelly, we know that's not true because in that Periscope video that I still have that he deleted, he clearly states he met R. Kelly in 1994, that R. Kelly mentored him because he was messing up in his life. And then he says in that exact same video that he just reconnected with R. Kelly. And that reconnection took place if you go back and listen to Sharon's video, Sharon talks about after that first hearing where Dana Jay was there. I think it's the one where he has on the leather jacket. And we talk about how he, you know, finagled his way into R. Kelly's circle to get R. Kelly to remember who he was. He says he reconnected with R. Kelly. And I believe it was at that, he said recently in the video, but I believe it was at that May 5th or 6th or wherever day it was hearing when the whole Jasmine situation took place. And then the only other thing I'm going to say about Dana Jay is this. So in one of his rants, because that's what he's been doing on all his videos is ranting, he made the comment that everyone turned against him after I did that video where I said that I didn't believe a lot of the stuff that he was saying. And so he claimed that I paid somebody $300 for a video or somebody paid me $300 to talk about a video. Whether I was paid $300 or I paid somebody $300, it's a lie, okay? So it's just another lie he has told, because Dana Jay is nobody in my life that I would be paying. And I mean, the only reason I even talk about him is because he inserted himself in the whole R. Kelly thing and came out, you know, it started out where, you know, he was talking about being a mentee of R. Kelly's when he was younger and on the Phases channel. And I was like, oh, okay, that makes sense. And then all of a sudden it went from him sharing how he met R. Kelly to all of this, okay? And I just felt that he got caught up in the hype. And then people keep saying, you know what, well, he's the only one that goes to court with R. Kelly. He's the one, you know, that's doing the rally and speaking on his behalf. Well, keep in mind that Geronda Pace did the same thing. Geronda Pace went to every R. Kelly court date, you know, and she spoke to the media. She was out there with her. I think one time she had a sign out there rallying for R. Kelly. So just because somebody goes to all of R. Kelly's court hearings and they're being vocal and supportive of him doesn't mean that they know him or have this close relationship with him. And so that was a lie about the $300. If you caught that, it only lasted about a few seconds on one of them videos, but somebody sent it to me and said, girl, go listen to minute such and such at what he just said. And so he basically said that there was a video that somebody paid $300 from. Either I paid $300 or somebody paid me $300 to talk about this footage. And I even went back to the video where I talked about Dana Jay for the first time. And I'm just like, there ain't even no video footage in this. So what happened to the $300 video that he's talking about? So just so you guys know, that is a complete and utter lie that he told in that video. And then there was a video that he did with Phases recently. And I think it was after the last court hearing where I did that video called Dana Jay's Big Rally, where I talk about, oh, Dana really did pull off the rally, blah, blah, blah. So they did a video. And so in that video, he pretends like he always does that he's about to go in and reveal all this information, you know, about somebody. But then he just keeps talking and talking and talking and never reveals the information. So in that video, once again, somebody was like, girl, go pull up this last interview that Phases did. Go to minute such and such and just watch. And so I did that. And so Dana picks up this envelope. So he was talking about me, and then he picks up this envelope about how he was finna reveal the truth about me. And then Phases said, oh no, don't do it. And then he was like, you know, let her keep talking or whatever. Let me tell y'all something. Like, I have not had a perfect life, but I have not had a life where I have done anything that I am embarrassed about. And personally, I believe that anything that we go through in life is a testimony to somebody else that we are going to meet along the way who may be going through something like that. So any experience that you've had, nobody should be able to embarrass you about your experiences. Your experiences are meant to help somebody else along the way. And then it got me to thinking, there was a post that I came across on Facebook, And it says, if you're reading this, you've already survived the worst thing that's happened to you so far, so you're equipped for whatever may come in the future. And I always thought that that was such a powerful post, and it's meaningful now because Dana J keep threatening people, and so whoever he's threatening to, you know, expose, let him expose it, you know, and be a testimony to somebody else. And then also to let you guys know, I don't just talk about R. Kelly on this channel. I started my channel in September 2016, and I think the last time I checked, I have 517 videos, 517 videos that I have done since September of 2016. So in those videos, I share stuff that has happened in my life, you know, things that I've gone through, and especially when I used to review Jada Pinkett Smith's The Red Table Talk. And so as I'm talking about the topics that she's talked about on the show, I share things about my life. So my life is an open book, okay? And if anybody want to know anything about my life, they can ask me. So Dana, please stop with trying to threaten people that you're going to expose something, because trust me, ain't nothing really happened. Like, the worst things that I can talk about didn't really happen to me. They happened to people that were associated with me, and then I share their experiences, but nothing bad has ever really happened in my life that I would be ashamed of anybody knowing. So knock it off, okay? But on a positive note, Sharon says that she has a documentary that she's put together that's coming out in the next week or so, and she has like a little promo that she did on her channels, and I know I keep calling her Sharon. Sharon has a documentary that she says that she's done that's coming out in another week or so. So you guys be on the lookout for that. And then Dr. Rice, you guys asked me about, overall, I think that Dr. Rice has a lot of good commentary. You know, I like his approach to talking about the hearing and how he compares it to other hearings that have taken place or other cases that have taken place. And so I used to follow Dr. Rice all the time. I really enjoyed his videos. But then when he brought the Kelly sisters on, I kind of like stepped back because I was like, oh, okay, that kind of went left. But then he redeemed himself from the Kelly sisters. And so I wasn't following as much as I was, but I would check in every now and then. And then about 3 weeks ago or a month ago, he did a video, and then at the end of the video, he had Jasmine, the Jasmine Johnson girl, on there. And so I was like, hold up, wait a minute, you know, like, what's going on? Because I remembered that whole fiasco and, you know, what different people were saying about what actually took place that week, once again, that first week of May or whatever, when R. Kelly had that hearing and everything jumped off. And so I was kind of questionable again. So I haven't really followed Dr. Rice as close as I used to, but I do get his notifications. And if the title is something that interests me, I'll go and check it out. Levi for Kelly. I don't follow Levi for Kelly. I watched one of his videos, I think when he first came out. And so, you know, I had some antennas to go up. And so I don't follow Levi for Kelly. So don't tell me to follow Levi for Kelly. Don't tell me to go watch Levi for Kelly, because it's not happening. And then Phases. So I used to follow Phases. I stumbled across Phases' channel before she started. I don't think she was talking about the R. Kelly stuff. If she was, it was just her and the camera, like it's just me and the camera. And so I really loved her content. And then I remember she was on TMZ one day when they do the viewer feedback. And I was like, oh my God, that's that lady from YouTube. And so, you know, I really loved her content in the beginning. I love her I like her content less now. You know, with the whole Dana J, how she keeps bringing Dana J on. And it wasn't so much that she had Dana J on her channel, because of course it's her channel and she can bring on her channel whoever she wants to bring on her channel. The part that got me was, you know, first it was him going on, and then, you know, starting to hear the discrepancies in his stories. But the big point of contention for me was when he made the comment about Sharon Wimbush and, you know, her, it actually being Jonjolyn Savage behind that page, and knowing that Sharon And knowing that FaZe's had Sharon, well, not Sharon on, like, physically, we could see her on her channel, but she did interview Sharon. And so for her to sit there and not dispute what Dana J was saying, and even if she believed what Dana J was saying, I felt like she owed it to her audience to do some research to find out if what he was saying was actually true. And if it came back that it was actually true, then, you know, give a disclaimer on her channel saying, okay, well, I interviewed this person. This is who I thought they were. You know, I've uncovered that it really wasn't her, and this is who the person was. But she never did that. And even when he came back again recently and made the same assertion, and when the twins, I think they even repeated what he said, like confirming that it was true. And not one time did she say, you know, let's not go down that road. That's not true. Sharon is very much alive. Or I went and researched and found out that it was true. Like, she never did any of that. And so that's what really bothered me about the whole phases part of it. And so I think I mentioned in that earlier video, basically, we don't know any of these people. Okay, these people just surfaced, you know, after, you know, the whole surviving R. Kelly, and then it came out that he was going to be indicted. Then all of these people came out because they wanted to support him and say, hey, this is the side of R. Kelly that I know. And, you know, it contradicts what was said on the surviving R. Kelly. And that was great. And that was exciting to a lot of us. But then it has kind of like turned into something totally different. And so that's why I have like been turned off from a lot of these people. And then I really stopped watching her channel after she brought the twins back and they were talking about that documentary. So if somebody, you know, messaged me and say, hey, go check out FaZe's last video. They're talking about you, or they mentioned this, or they mentioned that. I think you need to hear this. I'll go to that point where they say, listen, but as far as checking for her videos and sitting down watching all of her videos, I don't do that anymore. Then the other person that seems to keep popping up that you guys keep asking me about is Don Russell. And the only thing I know about Don Russell was the night that R. Kelly was released. The first time he was arrested and they went to the McDonald's and the cigar bar, when they were leaving the cigar bar, Don Russell talked to the media, and I thought that the comment or the response to the question that he gave was kind of against R. Kelly, and I didn't appreciate that. So I was like, R. Kelly need to get rid of him, and it seems that he did get rid of him, at least from a public standpoint. Don Russell was removed from the team, but then all of this stuff is coming up about, you know, Don Russell said this, Don Russell says that, and then on one hand, one person is saying, don't believe Don Russell, and then on the other hand, people are saying, do believe him, because he's still in R. Kelly's camp, he's still talking to R. Kelly, and so it's really confusing. But I don't follow Don Russell, one, because of the interview after the cigar bar, and two, because he, I think he talks in groups, or he created a Facebook group or something, and I don't follow groups, I don't join groups, and so I don't know what Don Russell is talking about. Someone did share with me, I guess one person was saying that Doug Anton has a defense fund for R. Kelly, where he's raising money to cover his expenses, for the lawyers. And then Don Russell said, don't give the money to Doug Anton, give the money to another attorney by the name of Brian Nix, who I didn't even know still worked for R. Kelly. And so personally, I'm not sending money to anybody, because I don't know who these people are. I don't know what their motives are. I don't know where this money is going. I mean, like, if you donate money to A View from Tracy's Point, that money's going to A View from Tracy's Point. But as far as donating money, saying that it's for his defense fund, I'm not following that, because, you know, just like they say that Doug Anton has a defense fund, but then when I check Doug Anton's social media, I don't see anything on his social media saying that he's doing a defense fund, that he's raising money. So I'm unclear on that as to what's really going on with the money being raised. So that's kind of it, you know, for Don Russell. I don't know what's going on with him. And so Phases, Dr. Rice, and Sharon and Sharon, those were really the only three YouTube channels that I followed in terms of R. Kelly. And I always waited until after I posted my content because it's real. Oh, and then Nick at Night, she's another one that talked about R. Kelly. And, you know, and I still follow her because she talks about a lot of different things. She's not just focused on R. Kelly. And then I'm also trying to get back to talking about, because this channel really was about recapping and reviewing TV shows, and so I want to get back to that. And you know, as things you know, as R. Kelly have hearings, then I'll come on and do a video about that. But as far as all the back and forth that's going on, I'm not going to talk about that anymore. People can say what they want to say, do what they want to do, but I am not going to talk about any of that. And then I am going to do another video because this video has went on so long. And I downloaded, it had to do with Angelo Clary falling out with Tim Savage over the James Mason guy. And remember, James Mason was R. Kelly's business manager, and Tim Savage had him arrested and charged with making a threat. Well, now Tim Savage and Angelo Clary have fallen out, and so he did a couple of videos, and then Joyce's sister Jay got involved. It was just a hot mess, but I'll do that in a separate video. I'm going to end this video now. Oh, and then one thing, you know, as far as, you know, all these other YouTubers, I'm going to respectfully ask that when you are making comments on my videos, that your comments be related to the content that I'm talking about. Please don't drop links to other YouTubers' channels in my comment sections. And please don't come back to me talking about, don't come in my comments talking about what another YouTuber has talked about on their channel that has zero to do with what I'm talking about on my channel. Just try to keep the conversation based on the content that I'm talking about. Try to avoid certain words when you're leaving your content. I know some of you were like, why did you delete my comment? Well, if you use certain words, your comments can be deleted by YouTube. And it's like usually anything centered around children and certain words, sexual words dealing with children, YouTube will delete your comment, or it will put it into a review status where I have to read the comment and then decide if the comment can be on, you know, can be released. And if you're saying, if you're cursing, if you're talking negatively about people, if you are just being ridiculous, like even if you don't support R. Kelly and you want to state your point of view, you can do that, but do so in a respectful manner. Don't try to antagonize people that support R. Kelly. You know, don't just be saying, just being nasty and low down and dirty, because your comment will be deleted. And depending on how ratchet you get, you'll be blocked. Okay, so it's like, time out for that. I don't have time for the negativity. I want to read the comments. I want to give feedback, you know, to some of the things that you guys are saying. And I don't want to be reading all that nonsense as I'm going down my channel. So try to keep your comments to what I am saying on the channel, what I'm talking about in that particular video. Don't share links to other people's videos, and don't bring commentary from other people's videos onto my videos, okay? So guys, let me know what you think. Rate the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And until the next time, I shall talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.